on the server, on our server, on Infinimita. But I will start on the, well, just describing a short description of the advantage and limitation of current analysis server. We already saw many examples during the morning. But actually, this is the limitation, this is the motivation for us to develop Affinimeter. And I will close my presentation by just mentioning some challenges and opportunities, which is work in progress, that things that we are implementing in Affinimeter. During the morning, well, we already saw a description, even historical description, evolution, and so on, of ITC calorimetry. We saw that the current instruments are highly sensitive. The power, the limit, the sensitivity of the detection for the power is less than 1 microwatt for the large generation instruments. The cell volume is decreasing, is tending to decrease, and well, it is around 200 microliters for large generation equipments. So, well, the technical description of the equipments are reasonably good to be able to apply to many applications, as we saw this morning. Drawbacks. I wouldn't say drawbacks. I could say room or opportunities to expand the applications of these instruments. So the advantages, I think, are focused on the hardware and also on the experimental methods that we already saw several examples this morning. The room to improve, instead of drawbacks, I would say room to improve, are spin around the development of the software. Actually, what we saw, not only we, but many ITC users were able to detect, is that the number of available models in the current software analysis is quite limited. So it works reasonably well for simple interactions, just one interaction. But if you want to do something a little bit more specific, it is not the models that are required are not available. So this is where we saw an opportunity, and this is the main motivation of our software, to develop our software. Additionally, well, we saw some other issues that we wanted to deal with, and well, based on this information, we decided to develop this software. This is a list of original functionalities for ITC analysis which are currently implemented in Affinimeter. I will focus my presentation on the description of many of these, or almost of almost all these features, these original functionalities. First of all, I will make a summary of the available models in our software. As you know, the current software of the commercial equipments make available a short, relatively short list of specific models for binding or dissociation of different processes, the dissociation or binding or aggregation processes. In Affinimeter, we don't have a short list of models. So what we have is an unlimited amount of models available to the user. So the user is able to design his or her own model just based on a model builder. I will show you how it works later in the presentation. But the point is that we don't have a limited amount of models, but that the user can design its his or her own model. And in particular, we have two different approach to define a given model. The one that we call, even if Adrian doesn't work, we have the approach which is called sequential binding based on stoichiometric equilibrium constant, or which equilibrium constants, and the approach based on independent site approaches. So what we have before doing an analysis with Affinimeter is to decide which model we are going to employ. This is based also on the knowledge of the system, on the knowledge of the system that you want to analyze. And then, well, of course, you have to know something. You just have to know the structure of your protein, or if you have a polymer, if the polymer experiences a conformational change or only binds different solids. You have one binding site of many, etc. No? You have aggregation, you have dissociation, you have to make any assumption before doing your analysis. So once you know, once you have some hypothesis on which you can base your model, you have to choose one of these approaches. When do you use the dependent size approach or the sequential binding based on stoichiometric equilibrium constants? Well, the first model is able to distinguish stoichiometers but not binding sites, this is important, while the second approach, it is able to distinguish both stoichiometries and also binding sites. Okay, so this is the first difference between both. The second difference is that the binding sites can interact with each other in the first approach, but in the second approach, the binding sites should be independent. This is also important. Well, in the first approach, we have two new parameters for chemical species, while in the second approach, we can group the binding sites in sets of identical equilibrium constants and delta H. In both approaches, we can deal with competitive binding. And, well, the first approach is useful for cooperative binding, while the second one does not consider cooperative binding since all the sites, the interaction sites, the binding sites, are independent from each other. This is just literature, so we can use some examples to illustrate how this works. This is one example, for instance. We know that if we want to study the interaction of a protein, which is, well, the nice picture on the left of the slide, with two ligands in a way in which the second binding site is created by the first one. So in this case, we have to go to the first approach. Another example is, well, in the case if we want to study two couple processes, like the dissociation of a heterodimer plus the binding of one of these molecules to the protein. This is suitable to be analyzed using the first approach. In which case I think it is better or best suitable to use the second one. For instance, in this case, I am showing you a protein with two completely independent binding sites. The binding sites do not interact with each other, so this is suitable to be studied using the second approach. In this case, if we use an independent site approach, we can have the equilibrium constant, the site equilibrium constant, which is different from the stoichiometric equilibrium constant, for each of the binding sites. So I get more information, the analysis is simple, and if the model is right for my system, I should be able to get information, the required information. This is another case which cannot be studied using the first approach for analysis. I have a D-block polymer, each block with a given number of interacting sites, and I can have, well, here I have stars and triangles which represent different molecules, and both are competing to bind each binding site in each of the blocks of this polymer. So if I use the first approach, I will need many parameters which we are not able to manage, while in the second one the system is all, it's reasonable. The number of fitting parameters is reasonable. So this can be generalized. So the sets of sites in the notation of the current software doesn't need to be grouped physically sequential. So it can be alternative and so on, and the model should work anyway. We don't have one site of binding sites or two sites. We have a multiple set of independent sites and even at the competitive level. So all these kind of models are already implemented and they are working in Affinimeter. It's okay this way? Yeah, okay, sorry. We know the system. We know how many models are available, we know how to define each model, so we have to make the input. If you don't have our software, you want to analyze the system and use these models, what you have to do is you have to write the equations, as Nick described this morning. You have to make a mass action model, you have to write not only the chemical reaction, but only the mathematical equations. You have to write the code to minimize the fitting parameters. You have to validate that the code works, and then you have to apply the model and get your results. So the process is long. Using Affinimeter, you only need to write the chemical equations. That's all. So this is how it works. Some examples. without any mathematical equation. No? You write, for instance, this chemical reaction using our model builder. You have just already all the parameters available to fit this model. But this is very simple, and this is already available in many other software. This describes the formation of a 1-1 complex. But this is a little bit more complicated. This is the dissociation process of dimers injected from the series into the sample cell that, upon dilution, dissociate, and then the aim of this experiment is to determine the dissociation constants or the association constants for the formation of these dimers plus the entropy. This is also quite simple. Another, a little bit more complicated case is the competition between two molecules, A and B, to bind for a given binding site into a macromolecule, which is represented here by M. It is important to know that in trophinemeter, the ligands can be in the cell or in the syringe. This is something similar, but now the process is a little bit different. We have here the competition between the association of a heterodimer, AB, represented as AB, injected from the syringe into the cell to give the formation of a MA complex. Finally, this is another typical case where we have the dissociation of trimers injected from the sample cell with, intermediate dimers. But, any of these reactions and also combination of these reactions can be analyzed using affinimeter. A crazy example. This can be done. So I agree that it is completely crazy, it is a nonsense, but it can be done. So any particular case of this reaction or any other reaction can be analyzed using our software. And the only thing you need to do is to apply the chemical scheme, the reaction scheme. So since it is possible to do crazy things, you need to validate them. You need to justify the model you are going to apply. So that is important. No? In order to do this, we provide a simulation tool which is able to simulate any experiment, any of these models. How it works? The idea is that you choose the model. The model is, I will use the mouse pointer to sign things in the slide to be able to be visible people out from this room. So you choose the model. In this case, is one of the samples I showed you two slides ago. And then once you have the model, automatically you can see the parameters, the equilibrium constants, and the entropy. Sorry, the quality of the image is not very good, but the idea is that you have the equilibrium constants and the entropy, so the parameters involved in the description of this model, in the description of the binding processes. And you have just to put the numbers, so the value of the equilibrium constants, of the association constants, and the value of the entropies, and what you see is exactly what is expected for the calorimetric signal, the isotherm. No? Then you see not only this, but also the distribution of chemical species. I mean the concentration in the red plot. What you see is the concentration of dimers and trimers, which is the chemical species involved in this model. I'm surprised that this morning many people have been talking about models and so on. And you know, and also the speakers know, that the concentration of free species, I mean, you have three molecules involved in your experiment, a protein and two ligands, the concentration of free monomers are involved in all the equations. And this is information that can be obtained from the fitting, but nobody uses it. So I think it is very useful. It is very useful because it is it provides information about the behavior of the system as a function of the concentration. So we know that at a given concentration, a given species dominates in the solution. So this is important mainly in developing of new materials and some fields, some specific fields. So this is an example of how the simulation tool works. Another different example, this is more interesting, I think, because the distribution of the species, the right plot, is different from each other. So here also we have in red the concentration of the complex, the Y1 complex, as a function of the total concentration of both of the stoichiometric ratio, and also the concentration of the N1 to 2 complex. So we see that as the concentration of A increase, the second species is able to displace the first one, and then dominates. At the end of the titration, the blue points dominate into the sample cell. So the concentration of A1 to 2 complex dominates. So, well, this is another example. I can show you many more. This is another one, a more complex one. In this case, you can see that, as I showed you before, this model is based on this reaction scheme, because it is a what I call sequential binding based on stoichiometric equilibrium constants. But for the second type of approach that we have implemented in Affinimeter, the model is defined just by the number of sets of sites. It's independent sites, so we have to give only the number of sites in the sets. In this case, we have two different sets of sites, the first one with 3 sites in this case, and the second one with 8 sites, and from there the model is defined. So we have just to put the equilibrium constant and entropies, and we get again the what is expected for the ITC isofair, for the, in this case it's not the distribution species, but the fraction of how the each set is being filled by the solutes. And this is another different example where the isotherm is a little bit different because the parameters are different. So you can simulate almost any molecular process based on the interaction between 3 different molecules. Okay, so this is for the simulation tool. The tools I have just shown, which are the model builder and the simulation tool, are completely free for any user. So you have only to register into Affinimeter, and you can use all these functionalities. They are useful for different things. They are useful to explain the results of an experiment and to analyze your data. They are useful also to design and optimize one experiment, because you can optimize the concentration of your molecules to saturate, for instance, the molecule which is in the cell. And we are also using it for lectures with other students, no? Because you can illustrate how it works, you can displace a molecule for another which is for which the affinity is higher, and so on. So it can be used for these 3 things. But if you want to do real analysis, you need to fit, to make fittings. So the fittings are based on the same principles. You need a model, you need data, you need real data, which are not required for simulation, and then you need to make the minimization, to get the parameters that are unknown. So in this case, for instance, I'm showing you the analysis, a global analysis of 2 different experiments at the same time. The global analysis is quite interesting. As you saw this morning, the other speakers introduced what is called direct experiment and reverse experiment. So the analysis, the simultaneous analysis of both experiments is useful because the fitting parameters are more restricted, the number of degrees of freedom, the number of degrees of freedom is lower, and then the statistical significance of each parameter is, it makes more sense, no? It's higher. So in this case, what we have is a global fitting of 2 different experiments where we are sharing parameters, we are fitting the same parameters for both experiments. This is something which is already working in Affinimeter, not only for 2 experiments, but for any number of experiments. You can analyze together 10 different isotherms if you want. Sorry. Can you hear me? Yeah, okay, sorry. Another functionality that it is already implemented is that usually, when you do an analysis based on a numerical algorithm, you need to provide a seed to start the iterative process. So the seed usually has to be very close to the final result, as close as possible. Yeah, as close as possible. So in Affine method, you don't need to provide a seed. You can just put R&D. This is the field where you have to put just R&D. R&D means random number. And then the software will automatically provide a random number between the lower and upper limits introduced to fit that parameter. So you don't need to worry about that. But here is the example I wanted to show you. Also, we have parameters to correct the concentration of the molecules involved in the experiment. As you know, ITC is a technique which is very, very sensitive to the concentration of anything or the solutes and macromolecules you use in your experiment. So you made a mistake in the concentration. This mistake will propagate along all the calculations, and the results will be completely nonsense. So this is very, very important. And in order to correct for any possible mistake in the concentration of any solute or in the macromolecule, we introduce parameters which is correct by a factor the concentration of all the molecules. No? So these are here where I'm pointing it now. Also, we can introduce, for a more powerful analysis of isoform, we can introduce the dynamic relationships between parameters and bounds. What this means? That, for instance, I have here a D-block polymer with I can represent by a model of two sets of sites, two independent sets of sites. So I have the triangles there, which can interact with any site. So the model we can use to describe this interaction is two sets of independent sites. It's the classical one, which is already implemented in other commercial software. And then, so we can get the first experiment, and we can fit these parameters in this way. But we can do a complementary analysis if we have, for any reason, we cannot separate, for instance, the presence of another co-solute. We can make, we can take two isophers, for instance, like this. Well, we have in one of them the co-solute, in another one only a single solute, and then the model in the second case involves many more, well, twice more parameters, but some of them are shared between both isoforms. So by doing a lot of fitting of both, the number of fitting parameters is lower in the second experiment, but I have to put here, well, it's not very clear to the public which is in this room. I hope it is more clear to the people connected online, but what I have written here is not a number to fit, this is not a fitting parameter. I wrote here just the equilibrium constant for the first relation. So this is a fitting parameter. The equilibrium constant in the first experiment, in the first isoform, is fitted. And in the second one, I'm not fitting it, but it is changing dynamically as it changes in the first curve. So we can do it for the first analysis, and then the number of fitting parameters in the second curve is lower. So the expected result is significantly more statistical. And we can also do that for the bounds, for the upper and lower limit for each allowed for each parameter. So we can introduce there not only the parameters which are being fitted, but also relationships between them. For instance, we can introduce the average between two equilibrium constants or two enthalpies or any other complex mathematical relationship. Well, this is just to extract more power from the analysis, from a complex analysis. We have also, well, we know that if we have a relatively high complexity, the number of fitting parameters can be high. If I have not enough experiments, perhaps I have local minima, so I have to analyze that. Increasing the number of experiments, the number of degrees of freedom can be reduced, so the fitting can be improved, but sometimes this cannot be done, or at least it has to be checked. So in order to do that, we introduce an analysis of local minima in a way, well, different ways. We have different approaches to study this. The first approach is to repeat the fitting many times, starting from different random seeds to see if the final result is the same. So in this case, if the result is the same, we can at least guess that the result is unique, unless we can see we have an evidence of local minima. So the repeats and the sampling can be increased just by changing some of the available parameters. And the result I get is a list with different local minima in the case where they are being obtained. No, if this list of local minima are all identical, then it is better, and we can trust that our model and our data is more accurate. The last functionality we have, the third functionality we have implemented to study the local minima is something similar to what Nick showed this morning, which is the plot of the three-dimensional plot of couples of two parameters as a function of chi squared. So we can see there that this is a map of the sampling, of all the sampling of during the minimization process, of the values for k and delta h, which are normalized in this plot, when the minimum is getting reached. So we can see there that in the three-dimensional plot, we have something that like a bottleneck here, and this is what is supposed to be the global minimum. So for this example, we can see that the local minima doesn't affect the equilibrium constant, because, well, it is quite similar for the black and red points, but it affects quite a lot to the delta H. So this is there is a serious effect there if we get as a solution the local minima. No? There are other examples for this. For example, in this case, we can see that we clearly have a local minimal also here. There is a bottleneck, but the effect for the delta H and also the equilibrium constant is not significant, because both are on top of each other. So here in this case, there is not significant effort. This is another different example, similar to the previous one, and here you can see another example where we also found a local minimal. There's a bottleneck here, but the effort is quite strong for both the equilibrium constant and also the delta H. So there are different things, different methods, different functionalities to study the presence, the effort, and so on of our local minimal during our fitting process. One of the last functionalities I want to show you is the management of the laboratory. You can create associated users. This is useful if you have to handle many people with different projects and so on. So you can be a master user, and you can create for your students or collaborators associate users, and then you can log in as one of your users and see everything they are doing. No? You can check the experiments, analysis, and so on. And almost to finish, as you saw this morning, Philippe showed you King-ITC. King-ITC is not only the tension of the equilibrium constants, of the kinetic constants, but also it is based on a accurate correction of the baseline line, and also automatic integration of the peaks, and so on. Also, there are many side effects, side consequences from the implementation of KinETC. KinETC is something that we are already working implementing together with Philippe Dumas, and this is something that will be available soon. It is not ready yet, but we can see here, for instance, the correction, the automatic correction of a baseline. Also from here, it is easy to get the automatic integration of the peaks, and also the maximum injection time, and so on, the parameters that we need to get the kinetic constant. This will be about, is expected to be probably at the end of this month. Well, work in progress, just to finish, things that we are dealing with is KinETC. We are trying to produce automatic generation to generate automatically detailed reports with statistical information, thermodynamic, and so on, about all the analysis, including plots, tables, reaction schemes, etc. We are we are in the process of implementing new models, new approaches, taking into account spontaneous aggregation at different levels, conformational chains, plus status states. We are also planning, this is more for the medium long term, then additional properties, the analysis of additional properties like SPR or spectroscopy, Like Natalia Markova mentioned this morning, we can do an orthogonal analysis of many properties studying the same system, so many variables are shared, and so the results can be more, much more reliable. We want to improve the design because there is room to improve, and more surprises that are expected to be available soon. This is the people behind the development of Affinimeter, including our scientific advisors. And well, if you want to know more, you can visit our website. Thank you for your attention. there is no chairman in this session, so if you have any question, I can tend to solve it. Okay, otherwise, yeah.
This is a question from Nila from Pennsylvania State University, and she is asking, in what respect in what respects is the software different from ZFAT?
Well, first, the definition of the model is free. We don't have a limited amount of models. So we can, the user is able to define any model. So you have available any model involved up to 3 different species. So this is the main difference. This is basically the main difference, the definition of the model. Also, I'm sure when I trust you have the same opinion, it is much easier to use, it's much user-friendly. These are the main differences. Also, well, the way in which it works, because we work on the cloud, so you can access our software from any device with internet connection, including mobile phones or tablets or so on. And of course, you can check my third transparent, which will be available online with all the list of functionalities. I think these are the major differences, but we have many more original implementations.